of industrial pollution, whether to air, water or land. We're encouraging British industry to develop new technologies to clean up the environment and minimize the amount of waste it produces. And we aim to recycle 50% of our household waste by the end of the century. Secondly, we shall be drawing up over the coming year our own environmental agenda for the decade ahead. That will cover energy, transport, agriculture, industry, everything which affects the environment. With regard to energy, we already have a £2 billion programme of improvements to reduce acid rain emissions from our power stations. We shall be looking more closely at the role of non-fossil fuel sources, including nuclear, in generating energy. And our latest legislation requires companies which supply electricity positively to promote energy efficiency. On transport, we shall look for ways to strengthen controls over vehicle emissions and to develop the lean burn engine, which offers a far better long-term solution than the three-way catalyst in terms of carbon dioxide and the greenhouse effect. We've already reduced the tax on lead-free petrol to encourage its use. That's an example of using market-based incentives to promote good environmental practice, and we shall see whether there are other areas where this same principle can be applied. With regard to agriculture, we recognize that farmers not only produce food, which they do with great efficiency, they need to conserve the beauty of the priceless heritage of our countryside. So we're therefore encouraging them to reduce the intensity of their methods and to conserve wildlife habitats. We're planting new woods and forests. Indeed, there's been a 50% increase in tree planting in Britain in the last 10 years. We also aim to reduce chemical inputs to the soil, and we're bringing forward measures to deal with the complex problem of nitrates in water. All that is part of our own 10-year program coming up to the end of this century. And third, we're increasing our investment in research into global environmental problems. I've already mentioned the Climate Change Center that we are establishing. In addition, we're supporting our own scientists, and in particular, the British Antarctic Survey's crucial contribution to the World Ocean Circulation Experiment, as well as the voyages of our aptly named research ship, the Charles Darwin. We've also provided more money for the climate and environment satellite monitoring programs of the European Space Agency. And fourth, we help poorer countries cope with their environmental problems through our aid program. We shall give special help to manage and preserve the tropical forests. We are already assisting in 20 countries and have recently signed agreements with India and Brazil. And as a new pledge, I can announce today that we aim to commit a further £100 million bilaterally to tropical forestry activities over the next 3 years, mostly within the framework of the Tropical Forestry Action Plan. That is all what we are doing in Britain under those four headings, all of those things. Mr. President, the environmental challenge, which confronts the whole world, demands an equivalent response from the whole world. Every country will be affected, and no one can opt out. We should work through this great organization and its agencies to secure worldwide agreements on ways to cope with the effects of climate change, the thinning of the ozone layer, and the loss of precious species. We need a realistic program of action and an equally realistic timetable. Each country has to contribute, and those countries who are industrialized must contribute more to help those who are not. The work ahead will be long and exacting. We should embark on it hopeful of success, not fearful of failure. I began with Charles Darwin and his work on the theory of evolution and the origin of species. Darwin's voyages were among the high points of scientific discovery. They were undertaken at a time when men and women felt growing confidence that we could not only understand the natural world, but we could master it too. Today, we've learned rather more humility and respect for the balance of nature. But another of the beliefs of Darwin's era should help to see us through, the belief in reason and the scientific method. Reason is humanity's special gift. It allows us to understand the structure of the nucleus. It enables us to explore the heavens. It helps us to conquer disease. Now we must use our reason to find a way in which we can live with nature and not dominate nature. At the end of a book which has helped many young people to shape their own sense of stewardship for our planet, its American author quotes one of our greatest English poems, Milton's Paradise Lost. When Adam, in that poem, asks about the movements of the heavens, Raphael the archangel refuses to answer. Let it speak, he says. The Maker's high magnificence, who built so spacious and his line stretched out so far, that man may know he dwells not in his own, an edifice too large for him to fill, lodged in a small partition, and the rest ordained for uses to his Lord best known. We need our reason to teach us today that we are not, that we must not try to be, lords of all we survey. We are not the lords. We are the Lord's creatures, the trustees of this planet, charged today with preserving life itself, preserving life with all its mystery and all its wonder. May we all be equal to that task. Thank you, Mr. President.
Big book.
You know the masks?
I don't know.
You took it.
Major economies.
I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of China to introduce an address by the head of state.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, I now have the honor to present the statement by His Excellency President Xi Jinping of the People's Republic of China. Mr. President, the year 2021 is a truly remarkable one for the Chinese people. This year marks the centenary of the Communist Party of China. It is also the 50th anniversary of the restoration of the lawful seat of the People's Republic of China in the United Nations, a historic event which will be solemnly commemorated by China. We will continue our active efforts to take China's cooperation with the United Nations to a new level and make new and greater contributions to advancing the noble cause of the UN. Mr. President, a year ago, global leaders attended the high-level meetings marking the 75th anniversary of the UN and issued a declaration pledging to fight COVID-19 in solidarity, tackle challenges together, uphold multilateralism, strengthen the role of the UN, and work for the common future of present and coming generations. 1 year on, our world is facing the combined impacts of changes unseen in a century and the COVID-19 pandemic. In all countries, people long for peace and development more than ever before. Their call for equity and justice is growing stronger, and they are more determined in pursuing win-win cooperation. Right now, COVID-19 is still raging in the world, and profound changes are taking place in human society. The world has entered a period of new turbulence and transformation. It falls on each and every responsible statesman to answer the questions of our times and make a historical choice with confidence, courage, and a sense of mission. First, we must beat COVID-19 and win this decisive fight crucial to the future of humanity. The history of world civilization is also one of fighting pandemics. Rising to challenges, humanity has always emerged in triumph and achieved greater development and advancement. The current pandemic may appear overwhelming, but we, humanity, will surely overcome it and prevail. We should always put people and their lives first and care about the life, value, and dignity of every individual. We need to respect science, take a science-based approach, and follow the laws of science. We need to both follow routine, targeted COVID-19 protocols and take emergency response measures, and both carry out epidemic control and promote economic and social development. We need to enhance coordinated global COVID-19 response and minimize the risk of cross-border virus transmission. Vaccination is our powerful weapon against COVID-19. I have stressed on many occasions the need to make vaccine a global public good and ensure vaccine accessibility and affordability in developing countries. Of pressing priority is to ensure the fair and equitable distribution of vaccines globally. China will strive to provide a total of 2 billion doses of vaccines to the world by the end of this year. In addition to donating $100 million to COVAX, China will donate 100 million doses of vaccines to other developing countries in the course of this year. China will continue to support and engage in global science-based origins tracing and stands firmly opposed to political maneuvering in whatever form. Second, we must revitalize the economy and pursue more robust, greener, and more balanced global development. development holds the key to people's well-being. Facing the severe shocks of COVID-19, we need to work together to steer global development towards a new stage of balanced, coordinated, and inclusive growth. To this end, I would like to propose a global development initiative. Staying committed to development as a priority, we need to put development high on the global macro policy agenda, strengthen policy coordination among major economies, and ensure policy continuity, consistency, and sustainability. We need to foster global development partnerships that are more equal and balanced, forge greater synergy among multilateral development operation, cooperation processes, and speed up the implementation of the UN 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. Staying committed to a people-centered approach, we should safeguard and improve people's livelihoods and protect and promote human rights through development, and make sure that development is for the people and by the people, and that its fruits are shared among the people. We should continue our work so that the people will have a greater sense of happiness, benefit, and security, and achieve well-rounded development. Staying committed to benefits for all, we should care about the special needs of developing countries. We may employ such means as debt suspension and development aid to help developing countries, particularly vulnerable ones facing exceptional difficulties, with the emphasis on addressing unbalanced and inadequate development among and within countries. Staying committed to innovation-driven development, we need to seize the historical opportunities created by the latest round of technological revolution and industrial transformation, redouble efforts to harness technological achievements to boost productivity and foster an open, fair, equitable, and non-discriminatory environment for the development of science and technology. We should foster new growth drivers in the post-COVID era and jointly achieve leapfrog development. Staying committed to harmony between man and nature. We need to improve global environmental governance, actively respond to climate change, and create a community of life for man and nature. We need to accelerate transition to a green and low-carbon economy and achieve green recovery and development. China will strive to peak carbon dioxide emissions before 2030 and achieve carbon neutrality before 2060. This requires tremendous hard work, and we will make every effort to meet these goals. China will step up support for other developing countries in developing green and low-carbon energy, and will not build new coal-fired power projects abroad. Staying committed to results-oriented actions, we need to increase input in development, advance on a priority basis cooperation on poverty alleviation, food security, COVID-19 response and vaccines, development financing, climate change and green development, industrialization, digital economy, and connectivity, among other areas, and accelerate implementation of the UN 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, so as to build a global community of development with a shared future. China has pledged an additional $3 billion of international assistance in the next 3 years to support developing countries in responding to COVID-19 and promoting economic and social recovery. Third, we must strengthen solidarity and promote mutual respect and win-win cooperation in conducting international relations. a world of peace and development should embrace civilizations of various forms and must accommodate diverse paths to modernization. Democracy is not a special right reserved to any individual country, but a right for the people of all countries to enjoy. Recent developments in the international situation show once again that military intervention from the outside and so-called democratic transformation entail nothing but harm. We need to advocate peace, development, equity, justice, democracy and freedom, which are the common values of humanity, and reject the practice of forming small circles or zero-sum games. Differences and problems among countries, hardly avoidable, need to be handled through dialogue and cooperation on the basis of equality and mutual respect. One country's success does not have to mean another country's failure. And the world is big enough to accommodate common development and progress of all countries. We need to pursue dialogue and inclusiveness over confrontation and exclusion. We need to build a new type of international relations based on mutual respect, equity, justice, and win-win cooperation, and do the best we can to expand the convergence of our interests and achieve the biggest synergy possible. The Chinese people have always celebrated and striven to pursue the vision of peace, amity, and harmony. China has never and will never invade or bully others or seek hegemony. China is always a builder of world peace, contributor to global development, defender of the international order, and provider of public goods. China will continue to bring the world new opportunities through its new development. Fourth, we must improve global governance and practice true multilateralism. In the world, there is only one international system, i.e., the international system with the United Nations at its core. There is only one international order, i.e., the international order underpinned by international law. And there is only one set of rules, i.e., the basic norms governing international relations underpinned by the purposes and principles of the UN Charter. The UN should hold high the banner of true multilateralism and serve as the central platform for countries to jointly safeguard universal security, share development achievements, and chart the course for the future of the world. The UN should stay committed to ensuring a stable international order, increasing the representation and say of developing countries in international affairs, and taking the lead in advancing democracy and rule of law in international relations. The UN should advance in a balanced manner, work in all the three areas of security, development, and human rights. It should set common agenda, highlight pressing issues, and focus on real actions, and see to it that commitments made by all parties to multilateralism are truly delivered. Mr. President, the world is once again at a historical crossroads. I'm convinced that the trend of peace, development, and advancement for humanity is irresistible. Let us bolster confidence, jointly address global threats and challenges, and work together to build a community with a shared future for mankind and a better world for all.
On behalf of the General Assembly, I wish to thank the President of the People's Republic of China for the statement just made. We have heard the last speaker in the general debate for this meeting. The fourth plenary meeting to continue with the general debate will be held immediately following the adjournment of this meeting. The meeting is adjourned. America's economy is booming like never before.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Since my election, we've added $10 trillion in wealth.
By His Excellency Donald Trump, President of the United States of America, I request protocol to escort His Excellency. On behalf of the General Assembly, I have the honor to welcome to the United Nations His Excellency Donald Trump, President of the United States of America, and to invite him to address the Assembly. You have the floor, sir.
Madam President, Mr. Secretary General, world leaders, ambassadors, and distinguished delegates. 1 year ago, I stood before you for the first time in this grand hall. I addressed the threats facing our world, and I presented a vision to achieve a brighter future for all of humanity. Today, I stand before the United Nations General Assembly share the extraordinary progress we've made. In less than 2 years, my administration has accomplished more than almost any administration in the history of our country. America's so true. Didn't expect that reaction, but that's okay. America's economy is booming like never before. Since my election, we've added $10 trillion in wealth. The stock market is at an all-time high in history, and jobless claims are at a 50-year low. African American, Hispanic American, and Asian American unemployment have all achieved their lowest levels ever recorded. We've added more than 4 million new jobs, including 500,000 manufacturing jobs. We have passed the biggest tax cuts and reforms in American history. We've started the construction of a major border wall, and we have greatly strengthened border security. We have secured record funding for our military, $700 billion this year, and $716 billion next year. Our military will soon be more powerful than it has ever been before. In other words, the United States is stronger, safer, and a richer country than it was when I assumed office less than 2 years ago. We are standing up for America and for the American people, and we are also standing up for the world. This is great news for our citizens and for peace-loving people everywhere. We believe that when nations respect the rights of their neighbors and defend the interests of their people, they can better work together to secure the blessings of safety, prosperity, and peace. Each of us here today is the emissary of a distinct culture, a rich history, and a people bound together by ties of memory, tradition, and the values that make our homelands like nowhere else on Earth. That is why America will always choose independence and cooperation over global governance, control, and domination. I honor the right of every nation in this room to pursue its own customs, beliefs, and traditions. The United States will not tell you how to live or work or worship. We only ask that you honor our sovereignty in return. From Warsaw to Brussels to Tokyo to Singapore, it has been my highest honor to represent the United States abroad. I have forged close relationships and friendships and strong partnerships with the leaders of many nations in this room, and our approach has always yielded incredible change. With support from many countries here today, we have engaged with North Korea to replace the specter of conflict with a bold and new push for peace. In June, I traveled to Singapore to meet face-to-face with North Korea's leader, Chairman Kim Jong-un. We had highly productive conversations and meetings, and we agreed that it was in both countries' interest to pursue the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Since that meeting, we have already seen a number of encouraging measures that few could have imagined only a short time ago. The missiles and rockets are no longer flying in every direction. Nuclear testing has stopped. Some military facilities are already being dismantled. Our hostages have been released, and as promised, the remains of our fallen heroes are being returned home to lay at rest in American soil. I would like to thank Chairman Kim for his courage and for the steps he has taken, though much work remains to be done. The sanctions will stay in place until denuclearization occurs. I also want to thank the many member states who helped us reach this moment, a moment that is actually far greater than people would understand, far greater, but for also their support and the critical support that we will all need going forward. Special thanks to President Moon of South Korea, Prime Minister Abe of Japan, and President Xi of China. In the Middle East, our new approach is also yielding great strides and very historic change. Following my trip to Saudi Arabia last year, the Gulf countries opened a new center to target terrorist financing. They are enforcing new sanctions, working with us to identify and track terrorist networks, and taking more responsibility for fighting terrorism and extremism in their own region. The UAE, Saudi Arabia, and Qatar have pledged billions of dollars to aid the people of Syria and Yemen, and they are pursuing multiple avenues to ending Yemen's horrible, horrific civil war. Ultimately, it is up to the nations of the region to decide what kind of future they want for themselves and their children. For that reason, the United States is working with the Gulf Cooperation Council, Jordan, and Egypt to establish a regional strategic alliance so that Middle Eastern nations can advance prosperity, stability, and security across their home region. Thanks to the United States military and our partnership with many of your nations, I am pleased to report that the bloodthirsty killers known as ISIS have been driven out from the territory they once held in Iraq and Syria. We will continue to work with friends and allies to deny radical Islamic terrorists any funding, territory, or support, or any means of infiltrating our borders. The ongoing tragedy in Syria is heartbreaking. Our shared goals
must be the de-escalation of military conflict, along with a political solution that honors the will of the Syrian people. In this vein, we urge the United Nations-led peace process be reinvigorated. But rest assured, the United States will respond if chemical weapons are deployed by the Assad regime. I commend the people of Jordan and other neighboring countries for hosting refugees from this very brutal civil war. As we see in Jordan, the most compassionate policy is to place refugees as close to their homes as possible, to ease their eventual return to be part of the rebuilding process. This approach also stretches finite resources to help far more people, increasing the impact of every dollar spent. Every solution to the humanitarian crisis in Syria must also include a strategy to address the brutal regime that has fueled and financed it, the corrupt dictatorship in Iran. Iran's leaders sow chaos, death, and destruction. They do not respect their neighbors or borders or the sovereign rights of nations. Instead, Iran's leaders plunder the nation's resources to enrich themselves and to spread mayhem across the Middle East and far beyond. The Iranian people are rightly outraged that their leaders have embezzled billions of dollars from Iran's treasury, seized valuable portions of the economy, and looted the people's religious endowments, all to line their own pockets and send their proxies to wage war. Not good. Iran's neighbors have paid a heavy toll for the region's agenda of aggression and expansion. That is why so many countries in the Middle East strongly supported my decision to withdraw the United States from the horrible 2015 Iran nuclear deal and reimpose nuclear sanctions. The Iran deal was a windfall for Iran's leaders. In the years since the deal was reached, Iran's military budget grew nearly 40%. The dictatorship used the funds to build nuclear-capable missiles, increase internal repression, finance terrorism, and fund havoc and slaughter in Syria and Yemen. The United States has launched a campaign of economic pressure to deny the regime the funds it needs to advance its bloody agenda. Last month, we began reimposing hard-hitting nuclear sanctions that have been lifted under the Iran deal. Additional sanctions will resume November 5th, and more will follow. And we are working with countries that import Iranian crude oil to cut their purchases substantially. We cannot allow the world's leading sponsor of terrorism to possess the planet's most dangerous weapons. We cannot allow a regime that chants death to America and that threatens Israel with annihilation to possess the means to deliver a nuclear warhead to any city on Earth. Just can't do it. We ask all nations to isolate Iran's regime as long as its aggression continues. And we ask all nations to support Iran's people as they struggle to reclaim their religious and righteous destiny. This year, we also took another significant step forward in the Middle East in recognition of every sovereign state to determine its own capital. I moved the U.S. Embassy in Israel to Jerusalem. The United States is committed to a future of peace and stability in the region, including peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians. That aim is advanced, not harmed, by acknowledging the obvious facts. America's policy of principled realism means we will not be held hostage to old dogmas, discredited ideologies, and so-called experts who have been proven wrong over the years, time and time again. This is true not only in matters of peace, but in matters of prosperity. We believe that trade must be fair and reciprocal. The United States will not be taken advantage of any longer. For decades, the United States opened its economy, the largest by far on Earth, with few conditions. We allowed foreign goods from all over the world to flow freely across our borders. Yet, other countries did not grant us fair and reciprocal access to their markets in return. Even worse, some countries abused their openness to dump their products, subsidize their goods, target our industries, and manipulate their currencies to gain unfair advantage over our country. As a result, our trade deficit ballooned to nearly $800 billion a year. For this reason, we are systematically renegotiating broken and bad trade deals. Last month, we announced a groundbreaking U.S.-Mexico trade agreement. And just yesterday, I stood with President Moon to announce the successful completion of the brand new U.S.-Korea trade deal. And this is just the beginning. Many nations in this hall will agree that the world trading system is in dire need of change. For example, countries were admitted to the World Trade Organization that violate every single principle on which the organization is based. While the United States and many other nations play by the rules, these countries use government-run industrial planning and state-owned enterprises to rig the system in their favor. They engage in relentless product dumping, forced technology transfer, and the theft of intellectual property. The United States lost over 3 million manufacturing jobs, nearly a quarter of all steel jobs, and 60,000 factories after China joined the WTO. And we have racked up $13 trillion in trade deficits over the last two decades. But those days are over. We will no longer tolerate such abuse. We will not allow our workers to be victimized, our companies to be cheated, and our wealth to be plundered and transferred.